फ्रेंड्स, अगेन लेट मी इंट्रोड्यूस माई सेल्फ एज डॉक्टर सी आर श्रीनिवास, प्रोफेसर ऑफ डर्माटोलॉजी. आई वर्क एट मणिपाल कोयम्बतूर, नाउ अटैच्ड टू मेडिकल कॉलेज एट भुवनेश्वर. सो वन ऑफ माई फेवरेट सब्जेक्ट हैज बीन कॉन्टैक्ट डर्माटाइटिस, एंड इन द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट डर्माटाइटिस, पार्थिनियम डर्माटाइटिस इज वन थिंग विच हैज रियली इनकलकेटेड माई इंटरेस्ट. इट हैज ड्रॉन माई इंटरेस्ट, एंड आई ओ माई इंटरेस्ट टू Dr. J.S. Pasricha, who is virtually his P is known for Parthenium, known for Pasricha. And it is from him that I got interested in this weed. This weed grows almost everywhere in India, especially along the roadside, and has caused havoc. Whenever I go past this weed, I feel like saluting it, because in spite of all our attempts for so many years, the weed still holds an upper hand. And we are not able to find a good solution to manage the dermatitis caused by this weed. So today I am going to give a talk on Parthenium dermatitis diagnosis, and I am going to talk on the missing link. A good talk has to flow like a river. In other words, there should not be any stop and starts. But today's talk is going to be a little different. I am going to jump from one aspect of Parthenium to another aspect of Parthenium, where I will move from one gear to another gear. That means, in other words, I'll be shifting the focus of my topic from one part of Parthenium to another part of Parthenium. So do join me for this ride, and let us try to understand this Parthenium weed and why it is baffling us to this great an extent. So these are the gear changes, I'll be changing them. This Parthenium dermatitis has got many phases. It can present in numerous ways. And in spite of being seeing so many cases, there are conditions or there are presentations which even a seasoned dermatologist may miss. Some of the common one is like airborne contact dermatitis, ABCD. Other is photodermatitis like pattern. It can also present like atopic dermatitis. Rarely it can involve the entire body and present as exfoliated dermatitis. It can only present as thickening of the skin, pigmentation of the skin over the forehead, like chronic actinic dermatitis or actinic reticuloid, and photosensitive lichenoid dermatitis. It can present as hand dermatitis. It can present as prurigo nodularis like lesion. And sometimes it can present in a totally unexpected way by which we cannot guess also. Parthenium dermatitis is sometimes difficult to diagnose. So this is a case of chronic actinic dermatitis due to Parthenium. It's a very disturbing condition. Itching is very severe, virtually driving the patient with a desire to put an end to their life. Such is the severity of this condition. And you all know about the skin, the different, because I'm addressing this basically to the dermatologist. You all know about the skin, about the various layers of the skin, the epidermis, the dermis, the Langerhans cells, the melanocytes, and the various structures in the skin. And Parthenium dermatitis is always believed to be caused by type 4 hypersensitivity. That means it is a delayed type of hypersensitivity. There are two types of hypersensitivity. One is the immediate, wherein when a person comes in contact with that, immediately the action starts. And other is a delayed, wherein the person starts reacting after a delay. And why this delay occurs? Because once a person gets sensitized, the T cells are in circulation, the memory T cells. And once the person is once again insulted by the same chemical, the various memory T cells from various places come to the site of insult and the dermatitis results. It has always been believed that Parthenium causes type 4, or the Parthenium dermatitis is because of type 4 type of hypersensitivity. This involves the T cells which are there waiting to act but cannot act unless the Langerhans cells pass on the information to the T cells. To detect this allergic contact dermatitis, we do a test known as patch testing, wherein we insult the person with the same chemical to which we suspect the person is allergic to. For example, if a person is sensitive to Parthenium, if you do patch test with Parthenium, then he will react to Parthenium and there will be a delayed reaction. That means if you apply today, the positive reaction is going to occur after 2 days. That is why we call it as delayed type of reaction, which we get in case of Parthenium, allergic contact dermatitis. But then Parthenium also causes type 1 type of hypersensitivity where sneezing occurs. Dr. Pasricha came to Manipal when I was working over there. with one Dr. Subba Rao, a giant from the Indian Institute of Science. He was interested in type 1 type of hypersensitivity, and Dr. Pasricha was interested in type 4 type of hypersensitivity. And I spent a lot of time listening to their discussion, imbibing this subject from them. Type 1 hypersensitivity, which is quite different from the type 4 type of hypersensitivity. Here the IgE molecule is involved and the mast cells are involved. It takes two IgE molecules. The two IgE molecules, they come to the surface of the mast cell. Once they come to the surface of the mast cell, the antigen comes between these two IgE immunoglobulin, and once these comes between these two, it triggers off the signals. And once the signal is triggered off, the mast cell liberates the various mediators. The immediate mediators in the mast cell is the histamine. And this histamine, following degranulation, histamine is liberated from the mast cells. As you can see, antigen is there. You can see the IgE on the top. You can see the allergen binding to the two IgE. And you can see that the inflammatory mediators are liberated, which results in rash, wheezing, vomiting, which is the feature of the type 1 hypersensitivity. This type 1 hypersensitivity can be detected by prick test. It's a very simple test wherein we have a negative control, which could be a saline. We have a positive control, which is a histamine. And then the substance to be tried, in this case, the parthenium, is kept at the center. We do a prick testing wherein we just enter the upper portion of the skin and leave it in the two sides, and then see whether a person develops reaction or not. So when the mast cell is liberated, it liberates histamine. Histamine causes vasodilatation, and when there is a vasodilatation, there is extravasation. When there is extravasation, there is edema, there is an urticarial lesion. So on prick testing, what we measure is the urticarial lesion caused by the release of histamine is what we measure. And when it is positive, it can be little more than saline or nearly two-thirds that of histamine. There are various ways to calculate that. Different people have different. But here it will be very clearly seen that there will be a positive reaction when we do a prick testing with parthenium in a person who also has type 1 type of hypersensitivity. Now let us imagine a scenario. Your mother is at home, or maybe wife at this age, and suddenly lot of guests come home. So when the multiple guests come home, like mother is not like Dobby. I don't know how many are fans of Harry Potter. I am. My son is. He's potty about Potter. So are we. And Dobby is a person who can click, and the minute he clicks, all the food items can come. Unfortunately, the mother or the wife or whoever is managing the kitchen on that day does not have the skills of Dobby, but they will have a refrigerator at home. So this refrigerator, we have ready food. There can be some cool drink over there or some snacks kept inside, which can be served to the guest immediately as soon as they come. And then once that is served, the lady goes in and starts making the cook, as we can see Jetafix, who is now cooking. Likewise, mast cell also has got certain immediate mediators, of which we can see histamine, proteases, and some cytokines are ready-made. They're waiting to be released. And once you stimulate the mast cell, tuck, they all get released and they cause the reaction. During this phase, while these are acting, the mast cell produces other mediators. They are the newly formed mediators. They could be intermediate mediators, delayed type of mediators, like lipooxygenases, the leukotrienes, and all are subsequently manufactured, prepared in the mast cell after the insult, and then they get released. And then they also can cause a reaction. That is known as a late phase reaction. In other words, the immediate reaction has got two phases. One is the early one, which is because of the histamine, and the late one, which is because of the other mediators, which is known as the late phase reaction. So what we need to understand that the type 1 reaction need not always be immediate. There can be a delay, which is because of the late phase reaction caused by the other mediators. So here you see the prick test in case of a parthenium. This person is sensitive to parthenium, and here we have done the prick test. On the top, we see the urticarial flare, which is because of the edema, which I already showed you, that edema occurs, and you can see the urticarial flare, and we can record this. However, if we come back after a period of 24 to 48 hours, sometimes even 6 hours if a person is very sensitive, a second reaction occurs. This reaction is not so easily visualized. It is better felt with the finger. It presents as an induration, and sometimes there can be a oozing. So a late phase reaction can be demonstrated to substance like parthenium in these cases, in parthenium dermatitis. So we did this study to find out type 1 and type 4. In other words, we wanted to see whether persons with parthenium dermatitis also have type 1 type of sensitivity in them, and we conducted this study. So we took patients who were clinically suggestive of parthenium dermatitis, and we did patch test, and only we took those patients who were positive practice, and in them we did prick test with histamine, saline, parthenium leaf, parthenium antigen, and we looked for the immediate and the delayed, and we also measured the serum IgE following, and we followed the Hanifin-Rajka's criteria. And this is the result we got. This you cannot see. I will summarize it for you. So of the persons whom we tested, 12 of the 14 patients, they were prick test positive. In other words, they showed type 1 hypersensitivity in addition to type 4 hypersensitivity. Mean IgE was elevated, IgE was elevated, and there was a very significant elevation of IgE. Almost all the persons had IgE level. In other words, all these persons with type 4 type of allergy to parthenium dermatitis also had type 1 type of allergy. So here again, you can see the immediate reaction at 15 minutes time. And then you can see the lower down where we can see the late phase reaction. And then you can see the patch test. Now, patch test is very interesting. Patch test is seen after 24 to 48 hours. And then we can put it as various ways of 1 plus positive, 2 plus positive, 3 plus positive. Various things are there. And the parthenium also will show patch test positive. But what I have observed that when we do patch test with parthenium, we not only get the positive, the various dermatitis, eczematous lesion, if we feel that, we can get an induration also. In other words, the positive reaction of parthenium is possibly because of both delayed allergy as well as the late phase hypersensitivity due to type 1. These two are acting in combination to cause the positive reaction. So we reported this type 1 and type 4 hypersensitivity occurring together. And this was one which we reported with Dr. Chemboli Lakshmi, who was a very important person in doing this study. Most of the studies were done by both of us. And this is where we reported both type 1 in parthenium dermatitis, we proved the type 1 hypersensitivity in these patients. This is a known thing. We are not discovered something great. It has been already reported with chrysanthemum, wherein a person has developed both. And chrysanthemum also belongs to the same compositae family to which parthenium belongs. Now, I'm changing the gear. I'm leaving this. That's what I said. This is going to be a sudden jump from one topic to another topic. I'm going to the next aspect of this. You all know of various duels. Some of them are very famous, like Martina versus Chris Lloyd, McEnroe versus John Bogue, and even now we have very great duels going on, Karunanidhi, Jayalalitha, Lal, Mammootty. So various duels are there. And in dermatology also, we had some giants who were great in their own way, but then held different opinions, which is justified. As we grow, and once a person retains a certain age, and he imbibes a lot of knowledge, then he develops certain opinion regarding the subject. And Dr. Bhutani felt that parthenium causes photoallergy, and Dr. Pasricha felt that it does not cause photoallergy, it causes only allergic contact dermatitis. So does parthenium cause photoallergy or not? The question is still debatable. There are many people who are in this field who still feel that, but I am one of those persons who feel that it only causes allergic contact dermatitis. It does not cause photosensitivity. The distribution is because of the allergic contact dermatitis. And the worsening following sunlight is not because of the photoallergy, but because of the aggravation following the exposure to light. But this issue is again debatable, and further studies are required to prove this more conclusively. We also found that the ability of a person to tolerate ultraviolet light is diminished in a person who has got parthenium dermatitis. In other words, these persons, the parthenium dermatitis persons, when we expose them to light, you will find that they are not able to tolerate UVB, they are not able to tolerate infrared, and they are not able to tolerate ultraviolet A. Now, most of the photosensitivity will be because of ultraviolet A. And these people, they cannot tolerate ultraviolet B also. And we found that the minimal erythema dose of ultraviolet B was significantly reduced in the person with parthenium dermatitis, which possibly is the reason as to why they react to sunlight. It is a non-specific sensitivity to sunlight. And then one more important person, like Dr. Lakshmi, the one person with whom I have worked before on this field, is Dr. Sruta Kirti Shanai from Manipal. And we have also produced published papers and done studies on this subject. And what I am telling is the various things we have, nothing I have done by myself. It is the combination of the various people like Kripa Shankar, Satish Pai, all those were the various persons with whom I have done the study during this long course of 30, 35 years, which I am trying to present to you in a capsulated form. So now we leave this behind and we change the gear and we go to another aspect of parthenium dermatitis. Now, to be a dermatologist, you have to have a great deal of suspicion. Suspicion is very, and that is the quality of a detective. And in consultation dermatologist, how to be a dermatology detective is written by Shelley and Shelley. And many of us, because we use a magnifying glass, we sort of think we are something like Sherlock Holmes, but which we are not. But we would like to be something like him. And then this led us to believe, this led me to believe, think that what about the insecticides? Like, we have a lot of mosquitoes. And for mosquitoes, we use mosquito repellent, the Good Night and Bygan and all those various, this thing is available by which we need it. And they have got a chemical known as D-alectrin. Alectrin is like the same chemical which is there in parthenium. It's a parthenoid type of chemical. So, but this is synthetic chemical. So is it possible that when a person puts on this or puts on the mosquito coil and it liberates this D-alectrin, is it going to aggravate the person who has got parthenium dermatitis or not, was the question. And the concentration of this all out or this good night or whatever is 1.6. And we patch tested the person with this chemical, good night chemical, as it is the persons who were allergic to parthenium. And what did we find? We found that almost all of them reacted to the good night or the all out. That means persons allergic to parthenium also were sensitive to this on patch testing. So we thought, this person should not put good light. But wait, that is not the answer. Because whenever we do patch test with some new chemical, it is possible that it could be an irritant reaction. So then we did patch test in control and we found that controls also reacted to the substance. Thereby, what we got was an irritant reaction, not an allergic reaction. So this being the case, we thought, let us dilute and see, because when you suspect that something is causing irritant reaction, it is possible that the same chemical can cause both allergic reaction and irritant reaction. At lower concentration, it may elicit allergy. At that concentration, which is not strong enough, it may not elicit the irritant contact dermatitis. At higher concentration, it may develop initially irritant contact dermatitis, and subsequently, over a period of time, when the concentration of the substance decreases as it moves from center to periphery, and when the concentration is not adequate to cause irritant dermatitis and the concentration decreases at the margin of the irritant reaction, we can get the allergic type of reaction. And we wanted to see whether we are able to elicit this or not. And out of the 15 volunteers, 9 developed sensitivity to this. This proved that this caused an irritant reaction and not necessarily. And so we opined that these chemicals are fine. Persons with allergic contact dermatitis can use it at home to avoid the mosquitoes. Now I change the gear again, go to another aspect of this subject. Long time ago, I came across one article in the Archives of Dermatology. It's a very interesting article, wherein a husband-wife person who go to the forest, who like hiking and all, they went for hiking, and after coming back from hiking, they folded their cloth and kept it in the cupboard. After 4 or 5 years or whatever duration, I don't remember which, they took and wore it, and within one day, they developed allergic reaction. And it was suspected because of poison ivy dermatitis, poison ivy. In other words, the poison ivy had come in contact with their clothing when they did the hiking, 5 to 6 years ago, and they had folded it and kept it, and that allergen had persisted for all this duration in the clothing, and when they wore it, they developed the dermatitis. This led me to think whether the clothing which is there, that can retain and cause aggravation of the dermatitis. So what we did was we took some stick, we took some gauze piece, we moistened it, and we stuck it among the parthenium, and then after 1 or 2 days, we took it out, and we did patch testing, and the person with parthenium dermatitis reacted to the clothing. In other words, the clothing, the parthenium weed can get impregnated on the clothes it comes in contact with, and a person who wears that clothing, if he's sensitive to parthenium, can develop allergic contact dermatitis. And we all, as I told you, it causes airborne contact dermatitis. People hang the wet cloth outside, and they hang the wet cloth outside. It is but natural that the dust is going to come and settle on it. It is quite possible that the parthenium dust may settle on it. And if the person adorns the same dust, they wear the same clothing, he may develop. And also, we give it to the laundry, and the laundry person is going to dry it by the river. At the side of the river, he is not going to see whether parthenium is there or not. All he wants is to dry the clothing. He will dry it, he will iron it, he will bring it, and the person will wear it, and they can develop the dermatitis. And we reported this in the archives, I think, that it can be, by clothing, can transmit the dermatitis. Then, we now again change the gear, go to another aspect of it. Now, parthenium, when it grows, other wheat cannot grow. Parthenium does not have any economic value. But can anyone be so useless? There should be some use in any person. Nothing, no one is absolutely useless. So, can parthenium be used for something? And I was invited to give a talk in the Agri University. I'll come to that later. Parthenium was being converted to compost. And this compost was being made by anaerobic and anaerobic method, and each for 45 days and 90 days. And after doing this, this was being used as a manure. So at last we found something for which parthenium could be of use to a human being as a manure. Because obviously parthenium, why is it growing? Why is it having so many chemicals? Why is it having why is it having parthenin, ambrosin? These are all chemicals. Some of them might have insect repellent property. So if this has got insect repellent property, and if we can use it as a manure, not only can it be a manure, these chemicals which are coming from natural source may also help in the growing of the plant, was the logic by which this composting was done with all good intentions. And this is the lovely Agri University, which is there in Coimbatore. And one of the most beautiful structures. Should you visit Coimbatore, do have a look at this place. And inside also, they got lovely old staircases and all. And here, there is a section where they are working on the field of parthenium. And one Dr. Chinnaswamy was the person. And he invited me for a lecture. And I am one of those shameless persons. I said, I want a gift. And what gift did I want? I wanted the manure which they made, the compost which they made. So he gave me 4 different composts of 45 days, 90 days, 45, 90 days of the anaerobic and aerobic. And this we brought back, and we tried to make an extract from this. We extracted the active, tried to extract the active principle after the whole thing has been composted. And then we did the patch test with that. We made antigens with what we extracted, the 4 different antigens. Again, we owe to Dr. Anand, who was there in biochemistry, who helped us in the biochemistry department, other, and Lakshmi also, of course, was very, very active in doing the studies. And we did the patch test with the compost as is, with 1% petrol atom insect and leaf and parthenium as we have. And lo and behold, the persons reacted to the compost. After all this process, in spite of that, the antigenicity of the parthenium is not lost. So compost, manure, if this is used as a manure, and if it is plowed, and then it becomes airborne, it can once again cause airborne contact dermatitis. So retention of allergic potential in parthenium was what we published based on this. I again change gear now, go to another aspect of parthenium. So we being Tamilians, I wanted to burn it and see. Like, people came and told me that they burn the parthenium. Hopefully I thought, by burning it, by completely burning it, the antigenicity will go off. So what we did was, I took this coffee filter. In the coffee filter, we kept the parthenium. We burnt it and we kept it. We completely burnt it. We made a charcoal out of it. And then we did the patch testing with that, and still it turned positive. So this antigen is not so easy to lose. And when Lakshmi made this mention to Dr. Lonkar, Arvind K. Lonkar, Arvind K. Lonkar, he is the person who reported parthenium. So Arvind K. Lonkar is from Pune. He is a private practitioner. He was the person who saw the link between this weed, and by patch testing, he proved the link. And when we were discussing this in Mumbai during the contact dermatitis, Dr. Arvind recently expired, so late Dr. Lonkar, he said, look, parthenium is like Parth. Parth, you know, is another name for Arjun. Arjun cannot be destroyed. Likewise, parthenium also cannot be destroyed, was what he said, and seems so true that parthenium is not so easily destroyable, and still we are looking at ways to destroy this parthenium weed. And what happens? Patient comes, we have to treat them, and then we treat them, and various drugs are given, and steroids are commonly given. Unfortunately, steroids are given for a long time, and when persons are given steroids for a long time, they develop the side effects of steroids, Cushingoid phases, prolonged story can lead to adrenocortical deficiency, and various features. So what happens when this person develops the steroid, or when someone tells them it is dangerous for you, when they stop the steroid, they develop symptoms which is indistinguishable from the primary disease that they have. So they only feel that the primary disease has got aggravated, and again they take more steroid, and this leads to numerous complications because of the steroid which I have listed over here. It can also cause cracking. So there are many conditions. First one is that of the parthenium. Some places outside they give for psoriasis, atopic dermatitis. These persons are in erythema nodosum, leprosum. You will think that person will come, they will again develop fever, they will develop vomiting. In ENL also we will get, in steroid withdrawal also we will get. Unless you are very, very conscious that it could be because of steroid withdrawal, you are likely to think that it is because of ENL and pump in more steroids to these persons. Especially for urticaria also, I have seen people who are steroid dependent because of the low dose of steroid. It is not the high dose of steroid. The low dose of continuous steroid can make a person dependent. And in them, if you do a baseline cortisol level, these persons with parthenium dermatitis, many of them who come to you, you will find that they are steroid dependent. And if you do, we will find that the steroid levels are very, very low, with a mean of 8.6, normal being 4.3 to 22.4. Now we have to withdraw the steroids in this. So can we withdraw the steroids in this case? We do a syntropin test wherein we inject 0.5 ml and then the sample is drawn after 30 minutes and we see if a person is there, whether the level is coming back with stimulation, whether it is coming back to normal. Unfortunately, it rose but did not come back to normal. In other words, we can try to withdraw the steroid, but steroid withdrawal should be very, very gradual, very, very slow in this case. Otherwise, they will develop the symptoms associated with steroid withdrawal. Recovery can take months in these people. Now I'm again changing the gear, going to another one. This was with Dr. Kripa Shankar. At that time, we read that people had tried oral hyposensitization with poison oak, poison ivy, urushiol, various things. There are reports of that. So we thought, can we hyposensitize? So with Dr. Iyengar, who was there in the pharmacognosy department, we made the parthenium powder. We made the powder. We made capsules with 0.01, 0.05, with gradually increasing doses. And we gave increasing doses to two patients with parthenium dermatitis to see whether the dermatitis goes off. In those two persons, it worked. It worked. But this will work only as long as it is given. And once you stop, once again, a person will come down. The theory could be because of the blocking antibody or whatever the theory it is. Once you stop, it comes back. And this can be associated with severe pruritus anemia. It has to be worked up. Subsequently, study was done by Dr. Sahu at PGMR at Chandigarh, and also found that oral hyposensitization is still an option we need to explore to work on this. The other drugs which we can use are the mycophenolate mofetil. Ours was the first group which proved that azathioprine can be used in the treatment of Parthenium dermatitis, which we reported in the British Journal of Dermatology. And subsequently, Dr. Pasricha did plenty of work with azathioprine, as did Dr. V.K. Sharma and Kaushal Verma. Kaushal Verma also came up with a new regimen of using pulse therapy. It works. When it works, it will work. But then we have to be extremely careful. I feel that there could be little risky. So there are certain ways by which I would say we should do a TPMT in the person. Even TPMT is not absolutely sure. We should start with a low dose of azathioprine, build up the dose of azathioprine, see if a person tolerates azathioprine, then we must give the pulse therapy, and not directly. But Dr. Kaushal Verma gave it directly, and he did not have any issues. And we are very happy that even the paper which he published was an award-winning paper. Methotrexate is another option reported by Dr. V.K. Sharma. Then we reported cyclosporine. Of all the various options, you will find that next to steroid, or as good as steroid, is cyclosporine, which is easier. So if a person is dependent on steroid, one can use cyclosporine, though it has also got the side effect, same as steroid. So we'll have to monitor the patient more carefully. But we can give cyclosporine to the person and gradually try to bring about improvement. Maybe we could reduce the cyclosporine to lower dose or twice a week regimen, along with topicals, along with azathioprine, along with mycophenolate mofetil, and slowly try to withdraw the cyclosporine and control this disease. But cyclosporine is by far one of the most effective molecule in treating this condition. Topically, tacrolimus, a calcineurin inhibitor, also is effective. And we did studies to find out about topical calcineurin, wherein we applied topical calcineurin, clobetasol, mometasone, and we tried to see whether it suppresses the late phase reaction as well as the early phase. And we found that tacrolimus could not suppress the early phase, but could suppress the LPR. Steroids suppress both. So early phase can be suppressed with oral antihistamines, and tacrolimus topically is a very good option. So to withdraw the topical steroid, tacrolimus is a drug of choice. To withdraw from oral steroid, cyclosporine and azathioprine would be the drug of choice. So these are topical steroids. Sunscreens can be used. Only thing is, sunscreens are awfully expensive, and has to be used 2.5 ml, has to be used 3 to 4 times daily. Whereas for a sunscreen to be effective, one can apply sunscreen above a sunscreen. Though it does not increase the SPF, you need not wash off the sunscreen. But when you're using sunscreen for Parthenium, you have to wash off the sunscreen before applying the next sunscreen, because of the fact that one layer of sunscreen, Parthenium can settle on that. If you apply another layer of sunscreen, it can trap it, occlude it, and then cause aggravation of the dermatitis. So you'll have to wash the sunscreen off, unlike the regular application of sunscreen. So this grass, Parthenium, is one of the most fascinating. Of late, unfortunately, I have not done much work, but that is how it goes. You work for some time and suddenly you find that there is some flash of idea which you get from somewhere, some person suggests, and once again you start working on it. Hopefully once again I will start doing something, and others also will start doing, or maybe some of these youngsters amongst you can take up, because Dr. Pasricha was doing, and people like V.K. Sharma, Kaushal, myself, we did. And what we are doing, we expect the youngsters amongst you to take up and work on this, because the person's Parthenium is really distant. But what we really need is this grass has to be cut off, has to be completely removed. And what we need is a good gardener. And we require gadgets more powerful than this to get rid of the Parthenium. Various things have been tried. Other plants like Xanthium have been tried. Insects have been tried to grow, destroy this Parthenium. But they in themselves will cause other issues. So Parthenium dermatitis, as of now, still holds the upper hand. And we are still making an effort to find out how we can. But then we do have treatment to make the patient more comfortable. Thank you. Thank you very much.